Good morning.
Good to see you again. My name is Cheryl Kirk. I'm a retired United Church minister. I served for many years at Trinity United Church here in town. And so I get called back occasionally to do a few jobs. So that's okay. Keeps you going, right? So I'm glad to be here. Also, most of you know, I think that my other connection with the Oaks is that my mom is here with Button. She's my mom, and so it's nice to be able to come and worship, lead the worship here. So let us enter into worship. Calls to our spirits, inviting us to worship. God's Spirit calls to our spirits, inviting us to love. God's Spirit calls to our spirits, calling us by name to grow in faith and to be made new. Come, let us worship our wondrous God. Mm-hmm. Let us pray. Draw near to us, Holy God, as we gather in worship this day. Encircle us with your love. Bless us with your sustaining presence. Surround us with your grace. Draw us around your living word and bind us to one another as disciples of Christ, whose Spirit is in our midst. Amen. For our scripture focus this morning, I'm going to be reading from the Gospel of John in the 16th chapter. A couple of short verses about what Jesus shared with his friends on the night before his death, as he was trying to prepare them for the tough times that were going to be ahead for them as he died, and they had to learn to live without their leader, their beloved friend, the one who showed them so much about who God is. So John 16, beginning to read at verse 20. Very truly, I tell you, you will weep and mourn, but the world will rejoice. You will have pain, but your pain will turn into joy. When a woman is in labor, she has pain because her hour has come. But when her child is born, she no longer remembers the anguish because of the joy of having brought a human being into this world. So you have pain now, but I will see you again, and your hearts will rejoice, and no one will take your joy from you. May God bless your understanding this portion from Scripture, and may it resonate in our hearts, teaching us messages for today. Were you ever afraid of the dark when you were young? Yeah? I betcha. Seems to be a common thing with children being afraid of the dark. Sue Monk Kidd, who is a writer well known for many books at this point, she tells a story of when her son was 3 years old. His name was Bob. We've got Bob Soans back there, so. This was little Bobby. Well, Bob was afraid of the dark. Sue tried everything she could think of to help him. But he would wake every night with night terrors. She tried leaving the light on in the hall. She tried a nightlight in the room. She tried special music. She tried the stars that she can get to circle on the sky. They talked, they read stories all about how to deal with fear. She got special stuffed friends that he could hold in the night. But none of it seemed to work. So one night she held him against her as she was trying to comfort him in his fear. Sue was pregnant at the time, and her little Bob reached out to touch her round belly. And then he asked, "Mama, is it dark in there where my little brother is?" "Yes," his loving mother replied, "it is dark in there." So Bob thought about this further, and then he asked, "He doesn't even have a nightlight, does he?" "No, there isn't a nightlight. Then Bob hugged his mother and she patted his head. He had one more question. "Do you think my little brother is scared in there all by himself?" Well, most of us do outgrow our fear of the dark, of the boogeyman in the closet, or the monster under our bed. Yet life can still be scary at times. We can be living in sunshine, and suddenly the darkness and the shadows can enter our lives at a startling speed. I think of a parent who opens the door to find a police officer there and knows that something terrible has happened. I think of a patient who hears the words, "We found tumor." I think of a partner who hears the words from their spouse, "I don't love you anymore." You all could come up with another list of things that have terrified you in your life. Maybe it was the decision that you could no longer live safely in your own home and you had to leave that beloved place. There are lots of things that can be scary. Lots of things that bring us fear and we wonder how we will ever make it through. Sometimes the shadow of difficulty comes so suddenly it takes our breath away and it cuts like a knife. Other times it's slower, like the numbing descent into depression that sucks the joy out of life, making everything seem gray and hopeless. Sometimes we bring the shadow times onto ourselves by the choices that we make, choices that are not life-giving. When we choose to live in. Sometimes we bring the shadow times onto ourselves by the choices that we make, choices that are not life-giving. When we choose to live in anger, revenge, addiction, deception, the shadows loom large in our lives. But other times it's nothing that we have done. We are not guilty or at fault because the shadow times come to all of us. We may lose that childhood fear of the dark, but I don't think we ever completely lose the fear of those shadow times coming into our lives. Jesus understood about that, and that's why he talked to his followers before he died, trying to give them something to cling to that would carry them through. He tried to give them an image that was strong. And so he talked about the experience of birth. He talked about the pain that a woman feels as she enters into labor. And those of you who have done it know it's overwhelming. It takes control, and you can lose sight sometimes of what the ultimate goal is in the struggle to give birth. It's called labor for a reason. It's hard and painful work, and yet there is a purpose to it. The pain is not for nothing. It is a purpose. There's a purpose beyond it. And of course, with the birthing process, the end is a wonderful new birth. Now, our struggle with pain and suffering does not always have that happy ending. It's true. But there is a different way that we can look at it rather than being caught so much in despair and hopelessness. We can see that this experience of suffering can bring forth other fruit in our lives. Because that's God, how God works in our lives. It's not that we become wrapped with bubble wrap so that nothing terrible can ever happen in our lives. Jesus said, you will have pain. You will have sorrow. You will have loss. But that is not the end of the story. That is not the end of the story of your life. You know, every experience of struggle, of suffering that I've had in my life has changed me. It's helped me to grow in new ways. It's strengthened my faith even as I've struggled with faith. It's helped me to grow. And I've learned new things about life. And I've become stronger inside. And my faith has been strengthened. And the lessons I've learned also have taught me how to be with other people in their times of struggle and hopelessness. I've learned more about how to be a minister from those times than the happy times in my life. I wish it was otherwise. I wish it was otherwise, but that's the truth. We grow more in pain and struggle than we do in times of joy. And thank goodness we get the times of joy, too, that help us through life. But if we can accept the pain and suffering, understand that it's normal in my life. I wish it was otherwise. I wish it was otherwise. But that's the truth. We grow more in pain and struggle than we do in times of joy. And thank goodness we get the times of joy, too, that help us through life. But if we can accept the pain and suffering, understand that it's normal, and understand that God comes to us in new ways in those times, it helps us to redeem that tough time, to be able to take the joy out of it, to take the new learning out of it, and to be able to move ahead. We are never alone in our suffering. God is already there. God is already working with us to bring good out of even the worst struggles in our lives. I want to return to the story that I began with about little Bobby. Remember, he asked his mom, Sue, "Do you think my baby brother is afraid alone by himself in your tummy?" This is how Sue answered the question. She said, "I don't think so, because he's not really alone. He's inside of me." And then she had an inspiration. She said, "It's the same way for you too. When it's dark and you think you are all alone by yourself, you really aren't. I carry you inside me in my heart. Sue looked into her little son's eyes, wondering if he understood what she meant. He thought for a moment, and then he trundled off to bed and was soon asleep.
Aww.
And that was the last time he had night terrors. Later that night, when Sue was in her bed, she heard the meaning of her words in an even deeper way. She heard God speaking to her using her own words. Sue, when it is dark and you think you are alone, all by yourself, you really aren't. I carry you inside me too, right in my heart. Now that's good news for us in the shadow times of our lives. Next time fear descends into your life and life takes on some frightening shadows, try to imagine yourself right in God's middle. For you are, and you always will be, right there in the heart of God. Thanks be to God.
Father, there is no shadow of turning.
God of all our yesterdays and God of all our tomorrows, we are thankful that you are supremely the God of our todays. We're grateful for the past with memories which are happy and pleasant. We're grateful for the people who have loved us, for those who have taught us and shown us by example how to follow in your way. We also give thanks for those who have helped us in time of trouble, those who have laughed with us in times of joy, those who have cried with us in times of sorrow. We give you thanks for your abiding presence with us in all of life, that we live and dwell within your very heart, and that we are never alone. Help us to reach out to ask for your strength as we need it daily, to cast our cares upon you, and daily to remember and to give thanks for the help you give us and the goodness that is still there, even in the midst of struggle. We pray now for the needs of others. We pray for those who know pain as a daily companion, for those who feel despair and hopelessness, for those who worry over decisions that must be made, for those who face death. We pray too for our family and friends. Especially this day, we pray for Lois as she faces this brain tumor, for the surgery that is to come very soon. We pray for her family, that they may bear this pain. Surround them with your love and bless her back to healing again. And we pray for David. May his strength return to his fragile body each day. May steps be made towards full healing. Bless his family too, as they struggle to be there for him. Finally, we pray for ourselves and our own needs. You know the places of hurt within us. You know our needs even better than we know them ourselves. For we ask for your blessing, your strength, your healing. We give you thanks and praise. And may we live our lives despite our limitations the best that we can, so that we can be pleasing to you, O God. And now we pray together using the words that Jesus taught his friends when he was teaching them how to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen.
What a friend we have in Jesus, all our sins and griefs to bear. And what a privilege to carry everything to God in prayer. Oh, what peace we often forfeit. Oh, what needless pain we bear. All not carry everything to God in prayer? Have we trials and temptations? Is there trouble anywhere? We should never be discouraged. Take it to the Lord in prayer. Can we find a friend so faithful who will all our sorrows share? Jesus knows our every weakness. Take it to the Lord in prayer.
And may the blessing of God uphold you and empower you to live as a follower of God's way, as revealed to us in Jesus Christ. Amen.
Amen.